I'm Charlie Brooker and you're watching Screenwipe, which for 1 week only is a programme all about television advertising. As long as there's been men, there's been salesmen. As long as there's been salesmen, there's been the great taste of advertising.
Adverts have been with us for thousands of years. The first recorded ones turned up in ancient Egypt, written on papyrus. Newspapers started carrying adverts in the 17th century, and almost immediately a code of regulatory standards had to be introduced because the claims they made were pretty much printed in bullshit.
As the media grew more sophisticated, so did the ads.
The first advert on British TV was this thing for Gibbs SR toothpaste in 1955. It's actually got a lot in common with modern-day ads. There's a graph that's utterly useless because it doesn't have any numbers on it, and a sciencey-sounding magic ingredient.
The tingle in SR comes from sodium ricinoleate.
Old adverts are like little nostalgia bombs, really. Each one sums up the era in which it appeared in an instant. 60s ads are cool and swinging.
With your feet on the ground, yes,
the 70s ads are sort of brown and grotty, whereas the 80s were characterised by power ballads and absolute swaggering f***ery like this.
You're looking sharp, you're looking good, you've come so far.
Yeah!
Relax, the best a man can get.
You know, if the best a man can get is a razor, that's probably why male suicide rates are so high.
90s ads were all huggy-wuggy and sophisticated. Whereas the noughties can't decide if they're all troubled and weird. Or inspirational, like this bloke whose cycling glory has prompted an identity crisis.
I am who I am. Because of everyone.
In summary, then, everyone's to blame for this. But there's one common thing that unites every generation of adverts, and that's that they've all featured a prime selection of absolute aching great cocks.
At number 10, friend chips, cock chips more like.
Okay, what's this one?
I don't know, a prick with some crisps in his hand?
I'm not sure if I'm entirely happy with this manicure.
Battle chips.
I wonder if this was as much fun to make as it is to watch.
You know what I mean, Harry?
Oh, f*** off.
And number 9, calm down there, it's only an abomination.
Unbelievable that some insurance companies don't want to insure me.
It's more unbelievable that someone will employ you. I think that's his O face.
Calm down, dear. It's a commercial. I'm only acting. I'm really a very good driver.
To be fair, this is better than Death Wish.
At number 8, it's Judgment Day at the jumble sale.
Pat, this isn't Nescafe.
Pat, you bitch!
Oh, it probably is Nescafe, but in a different jar.
Oh, don't you know anything, Pat, you f***ing idiot?
Nescafe don't make coffee for anyone else.
You're right. That's Nescafe, all right. And this? Let's forget it, shall we?
No, Pat, we won't forget it. We'll never forget what you did here today, you stupid turncoat whore. George Orwell called advertising the rattling of a stick inside a swill bucket, but it's actually an incredibly creative industry. And to find out just how creative it is, we spoke to an advertising insider.
For legal reasons, I have to point out our insider is played by an actor in a wig.
So you're in advertising, yes?
Yeah.
Sorry, that was a reflex action.
That's all right.
Oh, in that case, right. Sorry.
That's fine.
Anyway, perhaps you could start by telling us exactly what sort of is attracted to advertising in the first place.
Well, a lot of people have the idea that working in advertising gives you some kind of creative freedom. We don't. They siphon off any interesting thoughts you might have and use them all to sell boring everyday household objects like cat food.
So any creativity is hamstrung?
Well, that's assuming there was any creativity in the first place. A lot of ad agencies just don't care. They're just after new ideas and don't care where, how or who they get them from. Now, for the most part, advertising creative means person who spends a long time on the internet every day looking for other people's cool ideas that can be stolen and used to sell stuff.
Clients, what are they like?
they're the least creative people in the industry. They're the number crunchers, the marketing types. They understand branding, market share, and little else.
And would they actually come on a shoot?
Fuck yeah. When you're shooting, there's a cable running out the back of the camera into a nearby room where the image you're making is being watched by anything up to 30 people. Ad agencies, creatives, account people, clients and so on. All of them will have an opinion on the shot that's being set up. Once they've deliberated and some kind of moronic consensus has been achieved, a lackey walks back to the studio floor to tell the director what changes they want to make. It's a bit like trying to write a book while the editor, publisher and printer stand over your shoulder, nudging your arm and saying, "Don't push that key, push that one, no, that one."
What sort of thing are they looking out for?
Well, the load is a good one, normally pertaining to chewing gum or confectionery. That's the moment where the sweet is popped into the mouth. It's the loading moment.
Right, so the director's shooting a load into the actress's mouth.
Different gum companies have different ways they like their gum loaded. They publish booklets for directors to study so that the load is uniform across their ads. On any shoot, there'll probably be one poor sod from the client side whose sole job is to ensure that the load goes off according to company guidelines. If they come home without a proper loading shot, that poor fucker gets the sack.
Real-life ad men are completely horrible, obviously, and I say that with the absolute authority of someone who doesn't actually know any of them. But fictional ad men, them I like, especially these ones. Mad Men is a superb drama serial currently being repeated on BBC Four, detailing the lives of a group of 1960s advertising whizzos at the fictional Sterling Cooper agency. It's a heady mix of Hitchcockian glamour, intrigue, nostalgia, and scenes in which a silverhaired gentleman unexpectedly impersonates a fountain.
Whoa, 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 whoa!
That's not an impromptu tribute to Little Britain, by the way. It's a consequence of the sort of poor health choices most of the characters make. As befits the period, everyone in Mad Men smokes like they're trying to turn their lungs into a solid carbon block. And drinks like a divorcee at Christmas. It's surprisingly shocking to modern eyes, as is the casual chauvinism exhibited by each of the main characters.
Well, you're in the city now. Wouldn't be a sin for us to see your legs. If you pull your waist in a little bit, you might look like a woman.
The unfortunately named John Hamm plays the main character, Donald Draper. On the surface, the epitome of the clean-cut American businessman. Inside, a confused serial adulterer with a mysterious past that I won't spoil for those of you who haven't seen it, because I'm nice. Don occasionally knocks heads with up-and-coming whippersnapper Peter Campbell, an icily fascinating cold steel pebble of a thing, played to eerie perfection by Vincent Kartheiser. There's also Peggy Olson, ambitious secretary and one of the quirkiest TV characters in a long while. One of the keys to the show is that everyone's hiding something, and half the time, you're not really sure quite what, and neither are they. Despite their outer confidence, none of them seem to really know what they want, and even the closest relationships are somehow distant, as though they're being conducted through a thick layer of perspex. Just like advertising, it's all about the tension between the reality and the presentation. Mad Men operates in vaguely similar territory to Life on Mars in that it makes the past seem like not just a foreign country, but a completely different continent.
Now try not to be overwhelmed by all this technology. It looks complicated, but the men who designed it made it simple enough for a woman to use.
I sure hope so.
The first season of Mad Men is a slow burner, but it's well worth catching up with.
The second series starts on BBC Four next year, so this whole bit's been like an advert for that. I'm a whore.
Ombudsman Cigarettes. Good for you, good for your baby.
Early adverts were prone to making rash claims.
That's the trouble with advertising. It's an exercise in persuasion. And when you're trying to persuade somebody to do something, it's tempting to get economical with the truth. Miss Object, did you know that me and my wife have got an open relationship?
Fortunately, there are loads of guidelines to keep ads on the straight and narrow. Here are just a few of them.
The following products are unacceptable. Betting tips, pornography, psychic practices and exorcism, all tobacco products.
Although tobacco wasn't always taboo.
Until 1965, it was fine to advertise cigarettes on the box. In this exciting ad, some commoners were even encouraged to smoke more than one at a time to see which they preferred.
Each of them is smoking two cigarettes, an untipped cigarette and a churchman's tip. Which cigarette do you prefer? This one.
Smoking wasn't the sole preserve of real people. Even the cuddlesome, lovable Flintstones did their bit peddling yabba-dabba death.
Sadly, shortly after that was shot, he was diagnosed with cancer of the caveman.
Scientific terms or jargon should not be used to make claims appear to have a scientific basis they do not possess.
Scientific claims in ads are usually pretty fuzzy.
The science bit in adverts is generally an impressive CGI demonstration that dazzles but often avoids specific data, or a statistic that looks impressive but on closer examination might not be quite so convincing.
The language of advertising is an art in itself. It has to walk a fine line between exaggeration and fact, implying here, suggesting there, and leaving you with a sense that more has been said than has actually been said. Here's a few key phrases to look out for.
Help is a useful word because it's non-specific.
Enriched with collagen, it smooths and helps plump out the appearance of wrinkles.
After all, by stamping on the ground, you can help flatten the surface of the planet, although the noticeable difference may be minimal. Appears, another favourite, is not quite the same as is.
In just 1 hour, skin appears uncreased.
The appearance of something is not the same as the thing itself. When you listen to your friend's problems, you can appear to be a caring shoulder to cry on, but you might not give a toss. Then there's fight, which is not the same as stop.
Colgate Plaques has a clinically proven formula that fights plaque bacteria for 12 hours.
After all, you can fight a wall, but that doesn't mean you're going to knock it down. Not all claims are particularly scientific, even when they're this startling.
Yeah, it can be a bear pit in here.
I didn't ask.
When I'm under pressure, I chew Wrigley's gum. I find that the simple act of chewing helps me feel calmer, more relaxed.
Yeah, how about you try chewing on this?
When your busy lifestyle's getting to you, try chewing. It works for me.
Descriptions, claims and illustrations must not imply attributes, capabilities or performance beyond those that can be achieved in normal use.
Although weirdly they can imply that the effect it will have on you will make you behave like a twat.
There's a whole range of facial expressions human beings never pull in real life, only in commercials. Expressions which register emotions like delight, joy, pain or good value. Many products seem to have a side effect that makes you behave bizarrely, as seen in this unflinchingly realistic ad.
That is cool. I can really feel it. What a feeling!
In fact, it's so effective it makes everyone in the vicinity act like a complete wanker.
No advertisement may use images of very brief duration or any other technique which is likely to influence viewers without their being fully aware of what's been done.
Subliminal advertising, that's a few suggestive frames, is banned, although there are other permitted forms of subliminality, if that's a word, like music.
Advertisers like using music because it bypasses the rational part of your brain and lodges straight in your emotions like a harpoon.
In fact, according to a scientific study we've just made up, people can recall and recite up to 20,000 different jingles even when placed in a chemical coma.
0891 50 50 50. I'm loving it. I'd rather have a bowl of Cocoa Pops.
Advertisements must not cause serious or widespread offence against generally accepted moral, social or cultural standards.
Adverts aren't supposed to cause offence, which makes including shots of the human body, which is the single most offensive thing in the universe, a bit of a minefield.
Adverts for bathroom soapy fun products are traditionally little more than peekaboo strip shows in which the cameraman has to avoid showing anything too rude. In 1994, a landmark moment arrived when an exciting shower gel advert announced the discovery of women's nipples. This was considered so erotic it could only appear after the watershed in case viewers masturbated themselves to death, although anyone trying to pleasure themselves to a commercial is asking for trouble, because they're so short you're likely to find yourself reaching a crescendo during something about as sexy as a pig blowing off in your face.
Advertisements must not, without good reason, contain material which is likely to cause serious distress to significant numbers of viewers.
Although they do their best to scare the poop out of you in other ways.
In this blistering look at 1970s society, we see how anyone who fails to buy a chocolate bar that can be easily shared with attractive members of the opposite sex is a girlfriendless loser destined to catch the bus home and spend the evening wanking and tying a noose. The notion you'll be judged for your product choice continues to this day, it's just got a bit glossier.
You can tell a lot about a man by his style, his wristwatch, shoes, the company he keeps.
This advert subtly conveys how this metrosexual twat-a-ma-boob has become the envy of his chums and a veritable pussy catcher thanks to his mobile phone. At number 7, an ad too innocent for the horrid modern world.
You know, I can still remember the very first sweets given to me by my grandfather. They were Werther's original, and I was poor.
Why do I feel like I'm listening to this in a support group?
I remember feeling I must be someone very special when my granddad gave me his wonderful butter candy.
Yeah, but you weren't allowed to tell Mummy, were you?
After all, he's someone very special too, you know.
I'll get a room.
At number 6, Sudoku Face counts her fee for this gaudy reel of crud.
Imagine a loan that makes you feel free to live your life.
And spend it paying back a loan.
Yes, TV's Face of Math seems more interested in drawing your attention to the enticing numbers in the pretty balloons than the off-putting numbers in the small print, which might leave you in a bit of a conundrum.
It's easy.
You consonant vowel, consonant, consonant.
At number five, the greatest cartoon pairing since Dastardly and Hitler.
Hello, Money, how are you?
Hello, Access. Bit down, you know.
Oh, done much lately?
Not a lot.
Well, you're a dynamic character, thanks for the effort.
Don't you feel you're being used?
All the time. I'm accepted in over 100,000 establishments. Just like that.
You're not accepted here, you bastard.
At number four, ooh, it's the greatest romantic serial the world has ever seen.
Hello. I'm sorry to bother you, but I'm having a dinner party and I've run out of coffee.
Come in.
Thank you.
Oh, I think he's going to f*** her.
Will Gold Blend be too good for your guests?
Oh, I think they could get used to it.
Oh, she's going to f*** her.
It's a very sophisticated coffee.
Oh, he's going to f*** her.
They have very sophisticated taste.
Oh, she's definitely going to f*** him.
Do they?
F*** her.
Yes.
F*** him.
Well, I must be getting back.
Someone f*** someone.
How's the industry changed in the last 10 years?
Well, advertising's global now, so everything has to be standardised so it won't offend any of the cultures it will be shown to. Bizarre rules start to emerge, like the hero can't wear trainers because in Russia that means you're a gangster, or denim means you're a homosexual in Indonesia. Everything's homogenised and you're left with an unappealing slab of mulch. Some of these territories are very open about what skin colours they want on their TVs. I've been in meetings where a perfectly talented black actor has been on the table for a role, and the agency producer will say, up front as you like, forget it, he'd never play in Turkey or France or whatever. That kind of casual racism's commonplace.
Advertisements must not prejudice respect for human dignity or humiliate, stigmatise or undermine the standing of identifiable groups of people.
When it comes to minorities, ads today are a bit more tactful than they used to be.
Presenting Ribena's Black Currants.
Ribena's pure black currant juice. Ribena, Ribena. Coughs and colds, fatigue and flus. Ribena keeps away.
Mr. Bones, who was that lady I saw you with last night?
That was no lady. That was my current girlfriend.
Because he's a currant. A black currant.
Ribena, delicious.
Those were the bad old days, of course, although racial stereotyping persisted for longer than you might think.
Take this tactless 1986 commercial for frozen Chinese food, in which a group of Oriental chefs decide their livelihoods are at risk.
Who is lost?
We'll be ruined!
Ah, we are the Rosa! We rose out! We rose out!
Now that is lacist.
Another social group that's traditionally had a rough time at the hands of the ad man is the lady. Women always used to be submissive doll-like figures, like in this outdated Kame ad.
In a man's world, a woman needs a lovely, flawless complexion. Needs Kame for the skin men can't ignore.
Or dowdy housewives leading a glum existence in dreary cat food ads.
Could I have your whiskers? What a beautiful breath.
That cat's dead now.
Well, he really is a whiskers cat.
He's a dead whiskers cat.
And when they weren't doing that, they were effectively set dressing like the girl in this brilliant ad that deserves to be savoured in full.
Style. Where should we all find
power?
Where should we all find
space?
Where should we all find? Where should we all find?
Social attitudes changed, Adland's ladies changed with them. Suddenly they weren't going to take any more crap from disgusting men.
What's for supper?
Instead, they demanded respect.
R-E-S-P-E-C-T.
Subtly and on the soundtrack.
R-E-S-P-E-C-T.
Oh, bless her, she's worked out what the pedals do.
Before long, the worm had completely turned, and in sexy ads like this, women were allowed to treat men as sex objects and enjoy low-calorie drinks at the same time. And when they weren't lusting after men, they were treating them like dog shit.
Guess who's cooking tonight? He's butchering a chicken breast as we speak.
It's a blend of aromatic spices.
Did you get that? Aromatic spices.
Yeah.
Well, I'll call you tomorrow, if I'm still alive.
Which, with any luck, you won't be.
Advertising must not take advantage of children's inexperience or their natural credulity and sense of loyalty.
Some ads used to openly encourage kids to badger their parents, like in this downright nightmarish fruit gums ad.
Don't forget my fruit gums, Mum! I just love those fruit gums, Mum! Don't forget my tube of fruit gums, gums that last all day! Don't forget the fruit gums, Mum!
Yeah, pick them up on your way back from the therapist.
Today, obvious appeals to pester power are a no-no, but they're not really necessary, to be honest, because when you're a kid, you just instinctively want whatever's being advertised, like you've been programmed. I mean, I can remember when I was four, I desperately wanted some of these. And look how rubbish they are. They were just a load of pink blobs of vaguely human-shaped plastic that wobbled and didn't fall down. But I never got them, and in many ways, my life has never recovered, and that's why I live like this.
Advertisements must not encourage or condone excessive consumption of any food.
We're far too health conscious these days to let that happen, although in days of yore, we didn't give a toss.
Caroline Jeffries and Valerie Whiteman are disco birds.
In the artery-hardening past, fattening snack foods were promoted as though they were an essential part of the swinging lifestyle.
On the go, all the time. With Mars bars backing them all the way. There's glucose, sugar, milk and thick, thick chocolate in a Mars.
During the 80s, convenience food was the only thing the downtrodden proletarian workforce had left, and they clung to it like a religion, composing euphoric hymns in honour of processed meat products.
Oh, it's chips, we hope it's chips.
You know, it might not look like much, but that's a van full of dreams.
Today, we're all glum health fascists, though, and snack food advertising is generally frowned upon. As a result, current ads for not especially slimline food scarcely mention the product there, not even ads at all, but branded entertainment, which attempts to convey a vague sense of somethingness about the food, but largely seems to exist in order to give toe-brained cretins something to repeatedly call genius within earshot while you sit staring at a monitor in your cell of an office, fighting off overwhelming waves of sorrow and rage without ever letting them register on your face, not even for a second!
Advertisements must not link alcohol with sexual activity or success, or imply that alcohol can enhance attractiveness, suggest that alcohol has therapeutic qualities, nor offer it as a stimulant, sedative, mood changer, or source of nourishment, or to boost confidence.
There are about a billion rules covering the advertising of alcohol on TV. You're not allowed to show people drinking alone, you're not allowed to appeal to people under the age of 18, or even advertise in or near shows that appeal to people under 18, and you're not allowed to imply that alcohol will get you laid. Basically, you're not allowed to do anything.
There's hardly any old booze ads that could be shown these days, such as this cheery Carling ad in which a bloke is seen glugging alone.
How's it going, Fred?
Oh, I got it right, love.
Enough said.
Or the famously leery Hofmeister ads featuring George the Bear, whose cuddly laddishness might appeal to children. Even sophisticated liqueur ads like this are out thanks to their delicious air of sexual tension.
Delicious.
Just like you.
That's why the trend in recent years has been for ads which represent the drink in different artsy and oblique ways.
What sort of advert is the most tricky to shoot?
Cars are always a pain because it's all about getting low, sexy, sleek-looking shots of cars, the hot metal factor. There are guys who just shoot cars and make a lot of money doing it. You know that shot in pizza ads where the slice of pizza is pulled from the pie and the melted cheese snakes out in long, stringy tendrils? It's called a cheese pull, and there's one guy in the world who does all of them. He's the cheese pull man. He's as rich as Croesus, and he races cars in his spare time. That's what you can get if you're prepared to spend your life making melted cheese look sexy. You all right?
Oh, sorry, no, it's just you've really depressed me.
Sorry.
That's better. So, what's the future for advertising?
No one knows. In terms of uncertainty, it's where the music industry was 3 years ago. New media's come along and blown all the old models apart. They're all shitting themselves, basically, because the internet and Sky Plus has done a lot to empower consumers. If they don't like an ad, they just skip it. Even 10 years ago, you had a captive audience during the commercial break. Not anymore.
Well, we're going to take a short break now for some poetry with Tim Key.
Declan and Lynn were watching the ads and tutting. They were largely tutting because the ads were mainly for children's products. And in brackets, coming up to Christmas. Just giving you an idea of when this poem is set. One example would be that they were tutting when there was an advert for a child's remote-controlled toy who had eyes that lit up. At one point, Lynn muttered, "Fucking cynical, innit?" And Declan nodded. And then Declan knocked his squash over, so their dad, Aaron, came in. And Lynn, so they're both children. Declan and Lynn are both children, which we didn't sort of reveal. And Lynn pointed her podgy little hand at the goggle box, and Declan did his big brown doleful eyes act. And their dad, Aaron, started buying things online. Despicable.
Number three, a brilliant showcase for an ordinary, everyday, blokey chap geezer.
Well, they better not cancel football.
Who's that?
Mike, a pitcher. I'm sorting out the loan.
At Pitcher, we don't fuss or patronise.
We know what we're doing.
Really?
Yeah. Yes, we have a mortgage. How much do we want to borrow? Yeah. 25,000. How much is that?
Make it 75 grand. You'll never pay it back anyway.
How much is that a month? Oh, that's brilliant. That's much less than we're paying now.
Yeah, and you only have to keep it up for another 180 months, you tit.
And number two, a cheapo ad that sullied mankind's hitherto spotless reputation.
Don't know about you, but I'm really glad to be alive.
And at number one, the continuing epic romance gets bogged down in chit-chat.
If this were a restaurant, they'd be putting chairs on tables about now.
And I'd be asking you back to my place for coffee.
Stop talking about coffee and start f***ing.
I'm on the first flight to Milan in the morning.
That's terrible.
Why?
They don't serve gold blend in Milan.
I've had enough of this. Look, I think she's gonna f*** you.
You may be right.
So why are you banging on about coffee the whole time?
It's my job.
Yeah, well, sod that. The pair of you should be f***ing, not going on about...
I'm tasting coffee.
Ugh. Oh, all right.
Hello?
Right, look, yeah, if you don't f*** it, I'm going to come round and f*** you now.
So, in summary, what have we learned? Well, on the one hand, advertising is nothing but a glitzy shell around a puff of air. It's a tapestry of pointless dreams, a brainworm cynically designed to chew its way through your common sense. It's five times worse than the Nazis. And on the other hand, well,
And if you missed it, you can listen again to Charlie Brooker chatting to Nahal on the Radio 1 website. Next tonight on BBC 4, remarkable early colour footage in the 30s in colour.
Oh, advertising, who cares? Cheers.